Let's take a look at creating smart dependent drop-down lists. Now, there are two challenges that we're faced with here. Number one is that the list for the dependent drop-down should expand automatically as new data is added to our source data. And number two is that the dependent lists have different lengths. So we want to make sure that our dependent list is compressed to just show the values. So there shouldn't be any empty fields below in that list. These are actually two common questions I get when people watch my drop-down list playlist. We're going to address both right now. I'm going to show you two different versions on how you can get this done. The first version uses the offset formula, and the second version uses table referencing. Now, our sample data is this. We have different divisions, productivity, games, and utility, and we have different apps that belong to that division. Let's start off with offset first. As a first step, I need to have my main dropdown. That's basically this list here. So all I'm going to do is go to data, go to data validation, select list. As the source, that's going to be equal to these three cells here. And I have my productivity, games, and utility. So now comes the difficult part. We need to find a formula that we can plug into the data validation box here that's going to give us the effect that we're going for. So basically, it's going to restrict our list to the values it sees here. Now, one formula that can help with that is the offset formula. So as a first step, I'm just going to write the formula right here because it's difficult to write it inside the data validation. We don't get any help with the Excel arguments that we need there. And once we're happy with it, once we see that it works, I'm going to plug it in to the data validation. Now, offset can be a little bit confusing to get the hang of at first. So I do recommend that you watch my offset video that just explains the basic of this formula first, if you're not familiar with offset yet. And if you are familiar with it, let's get started. First thing I need is a starting point, right? So just see it like you want to move on a map, you want to get somewhere. So in this case, my starting point, I'll go with this one, right? So it just has to be close to your data. Normally, it's at the beginning of your data. Next argument I need here is how many rows do I want to move down? Well, I don't want productivity included in my second dropdown. I just want to show the apps that are inside the productivity division. So I do want to move down one cell, right? Because I want to start right here. Next is how many columns do I want to move? Well, that really depends on what the first dropdown says, right? So if the user selected productivity, I don't want to move any columns. I want to stay there. If they selected games, I do want to move one column, right? So here the match formula can come in handy. Why? Because the match formula returns a number. Right, so it returns an address. It tells offset how much to move. First argument in match is the lookup value. What are we looking for? This one, right? So I'm going to fix it with the F4 key. Next is, where is it looking this up? Well, they are right here. Let's fix it with F4. And the last argument is if we're looking for an exact match or not. In this case, we are, so I'm going to put a zero in there. Okay, so that's how much we want to move, but there is something that we need to take care of because match starts to count from here, right? So if it finds productivity, it actually returns a one, right? So let's just double check that. I'm just going to highlight this and press F9, and we see it's a one. So right now, what's going to happen is that we're actually going to move one this way. We don't want that. We want to stay there. So we actually have to make a correction by deducting one from our match result. Now, next argument is the height. And that's the important one, right? Because that's something we need dynamic. We want to restrict our result to the number of apps that we have listed here, right? So here we need some type of dynamic formula, but let's just leave it out for now. Let's just make sure that everything else works fine. And then let's come back and revise this. So for height, I'm just going to pick one right now. Next is gonna be the width. So how many columns we want included? Well, we just wanna include one column in there, right? So I'm just gonna put one, or we can skip that argument. It's an optional argument. And let's close the bracket here just to make sure our offset works and we are in the same column. So for productivity, we get Venkal. For games, we get fighter. So that works fine. Now check this out. If I change the one here, so that was the height argument. If I change it to, let's say, 6 and I press enter, Excel just shows me fighter here in the cell because it can't put 6 results in one cell. But I can actually check what's behind this. So if I click right here and click on F9, I can see 6 apps here. Now the challenge is to get this 6 to be dynamic because I want it to be as many apps as I have under games, right? But if I'm in productivity, I need that list to be longer. So I'm just gonna press Control Z to go back here. Now let's go back and revise this 6 and see how we can make it dynamic. Well, one formula that comes in handy here is the count A formula, because we can count how many cells have text in them, right? So remember, there is a difference between the count formula and the count A formula. The count formula only counts cells that have numbers in them, and count A doesn't care if they have numbers or text, it counts everything. So in this case, I'm gonna use count A, but I can't just reference my cells to be this, right? I can't do that because sometimes I want them to be the A column, sometimes B, and sometimes C column. So exactly this part of count A is something that we need to make variable. And here again, the offset formula comes into play. So again, let's start off with our reference, which is our starting point. That's going to be the same. I'm going to pick this one, press F4 to fix it. Now, how many rows do I want to move down? Well, I do want to still go down one row. How many columns do I want to move? That's the same as I had before. So that's basically exactly this formula here. So I'm just going to copy and paste it right here. Now comes the height argument, right? So I'm actually dealing with the height argument inside the original height argument. And right now I'm actually gonna fix that. I'm gonna give it a much bigger height than I expect to have in my table, just to make sure that I do include additional cells below this. So if new data come in and new apps come in, they're gonna get reflected in my result. Right, so I'm gonna actually fix that to a bigger number. And I'm gonna go with 20 in this case, but you just have to adjust this for your own needs. Okay, so in this case, we're fixing it. The width, we just want one column. So I'm just gonna put a 1 in there. Okay, so this bracket closes the offset formula. And now I'm gonna close off my count A formula and press enter. Okay. So now let's check this out. Let's just highlight that count A part, so the original height argument of offset, and let's click on F9 to see what we get. We have 12. So under games, I must have 12 cells in there. So let's just press escape to leave. I'm gonna highlight this, and the count is 12. I can see on the bottom, the count is 12. Okay, so this looks good. Let's just change this to productivity. I can check the count, but what I can also do is click here inside the formula box and click on F9, and I can see everything listed here until the last app here. So I'm gonna press escape to leave. Now I'm happy with this formula. I'm gonna copy it, Control C, escape to leave. Now let's go back to data validation. Let's click on list and let's paste this formula. Okay, so now let's check productivity. It's until here is fine. Let's add something new. We can see it here. Let's switch to games. Perfect. Let's switch to utility. This looks great as well. Let's just add something here just to double check. And that gets reflected in there. Okay, so that just required a formula and then plugging in that formula inside the data validation box. Okay, so now let's take a look at another way of doing this, and that's using table referencing together with the index formula. So what I've already done here is the first dropdown. Okay, so that's for the parent, the division. Now for the second dropdown, what I'm gonna do is to turn this data set into a table, but not one table, instead three separate tables. Okay, so I'm gonna click on productivity first, control shift down to highlight this area, press control T. My table does have headers, so I'm gonna say okay. I'm just gonna leave that design and change the name here, table prod, press enter. I'm going to repeat that for the other one, so control shift down, control T, enter, table game, table utility. Okay, so I have three different tables, three different names. Now what I'm going to do is to use the index formula to figure out the right table. So let's do it here first, and then let's copy and paste it in the data validation. And now I'm going to do something different. I'm actually going to use the second type of referencing here for the index formula. So I'm going to work with areas. I have three areas. I have my productivity, game, and utility areas. So what I'm going to do is highlight them. And I'm going to hover over the table header here and click on this area. I get the table name and then I get the table header. Notice if I put a comma here, it thinks I'm moving to the next argument, right? But I actually don't want to move to the next argument here. I want to add in this area and I want to add in this area. Okay, I don't want to go to the column argument. So what I need to do to stay in the same argument is to add these references in their own brackets, right? So to bring them together in the bracket. And notice now, when I move to the next argument, I'm moving to the row argument. These three references are now considered to be in the first argument. For the row number, how many rows do I want to move down? Well, in this case, I want to include all the rows, right? I don't want to move down any rows. Each single row here should be included in my end result. So I'm going to skip that argument. Next is the column number. How many columns do I want to move? And here I just have one column for each area. I don't want to move any columns inside that area. So I'm just going to skip that argument. Now comes how many areas do I want to move? And that is given by my match formula, just like the way we had it in the previous example. We're going to look productivity up, F4 to fix it. Where are we looking this up? We're looking it up right here. I'm going to press F4 to fix it. And we want an exact match, bracket closed, press enter. Okay, it's giving us the first cell that it sees right here. It's just because I'm copying and pasting this formula right in front of this, right? This is called implicit intersection. If I actually paste it somewhere here, we get value, right? So don't worry if in your case you're getting value. If you click inside your formula and you press F9, you should see the full list behind that. And this looks good. Just don't press enter, press control Z or escape to leave. Okay, so as the last step, we said, I want to copy and paste this inside the data validation, right? So let's try to do that. I'm going to go to data validation, click on list, paste this in and click on okay. I run into a problem because the data validation doesn't like this type of table referencing. And whenever you come across this limitation, what you need to do is to paste this first inside Name Manager. So just create a name out of this. So go to Formulas, go to Name Manager. These are the three different tables that I have here. Click on New, give your formula a new name. I'm just gonna call it My List and paste in your formula right here. And then click on OK and close. Okay, so now go back to data validation, go to list, and let's put in the name, which I forgot what it was. So I'm going to click on F3. That brings up my names. It was my list, and click on OK. So now I get Wenkel, to didactic. And if I switch to games, my list should be much shorter. Now let's add something to this. So let's say new game two, and it should get reflected in here. Okay, so that's how you can create dependent drop-down lists that are not just dynamic, but they also have different lengths. I hope you like this video. If you did, if you learned something new, don't forget to give it a thumbs up. And if you want to become more advanced in Excel and you haven't subscribed to this channel, consider subscribing.